Hello everyone. Today I am making this video to explain this particular sentence, that is nystagmus related to semicircular canal and its projections changes trajectory as per the gaze. So let us see. We know that there are 9 cardinal gazes in which we test the eye movements, and the nystagmus related to the especially the vertical semicircular canal, for example BBPV, is mixed, that is vertical torsional in the center gaze, and it becomes predominantly vertical on one side and it becomes predominantly torsional on the other side of the gaze. The nystagmus remains loyal to the canal frame, semicircular canal frame or head frame. So even if the visual axis is changing, it is remaining loyal to the head frame or the semicircular canal frame, not to the eye reference frame. So in this example, look at this nystagmus. This nystagmus is downbeating torsional in the center gaze. And on right gaze, it is downbeating, predominantly downbeating. And on the left gaze, if you can appreciate, look at the light. Here you can't see the vessels, so look at the light. So you can appreciate the torsional component. This is an exceptional example, but routinely in case of posterior canal BPPV, what you get is you see abating torsional in the center gaze, and on one gaze you see predominantly abating and on another gaze you see predominantly torsional. So why that happens, let us see. For that we need to go into the basics, and there are three things which we need to discuss. The first one is action of extraocular muscle, second is pathophysiology of BPPV, and third is vestibulo-ocular reflex. Let us go one by one. So coming to the action of extraocular muscles, we know that the extraocular muscles are divided into muscles acting on the lid, that is levator palpebris superioris, and muscle acting on the eyeball are 4 recti and 2 oblique muscles. Okay, and this is the schematic diagram showing it. We need to understand two things, that is what is meant by a muscle action and what is meant by a field of action. The muscle action is divided into 3 types, that is primary action, which is a robust action seen in center gaze. The secondary action is nothing but action seen in abduction, adduction, elevation or depression. And the tertiary action is action seen in oblique gazes. And the field of action is major action when the eyeball is aligned to the muscle axis. Okay, so that is the difference between the two. Suppose this one is right eye and this one is a left eye. The right gaze is brought about by right lateral rectus, which causes abduction of right eye, and the adduction of the left eye is done by left medial rectus. Okay, if a patient elevates in the right gaze, right superior rectus causes elevation in abducted eye, and the elevation in the adducted eye is brought about by the left inferior oblique. Coming to the depression in right gaze, the depression in the abduction is done by right inferior rectus, and depression in the adduction is done by the left superior oblique. So this is the summary of action of these muscles. So it is going to get more complicated as we go further. Let us see now the other actions. When the patient looks in the left gaze, if the upper pole of the eye moves towards the left, there will be intorsion of the right eye and there will be extorsion of the left eye. If when the upper pole of the eyeball moves to the left, then there is intorsion of the right eye and there is extorsion of the left eye. Okay, now let us see which muscles bring this action. So right superior rectus, in abducted eye it was causing elevation. The same muscle causes intorsion of the right eye in adducted position, and left inferior oblique, which was elevator in the adducted eye, it causes extorsion in the abducted eye. Let us see when the upper pole moves to the right side. there is extortion of the right eye and intorsion of the left eye. So the extortion of the right eye is brought about by right inferior rectus, and intorsion of the left eye is brought about by left superior oblique. Summary of action of these muscles. So the right superior rectus causes elevation in abducted eye, and it the same muscle causes intorsion in adducted eye. Right inferior rectus causes depression in abducted eye, and it causes extorsion in adducted eye. Left superior oblique causes depression in adducted eye, and it causes intorsion in abducted eye. Left inferior oblique causes elevation in adducted eye, and it causes extorsion in abducted eye. Here you need to note one thing, that those which are marked in red are the field of action of the muscles. These are the action of these muscles in the center gaze. So the right superior rectus causes both elevation and intorsion in the primary gaze. Right inferior rectus causes depression and extorsion in the primary gaze. Left inferior oblique causes elevation, extorsion in the primary gaze. Left superior oblique causes depression and intorsion in the primary gaze. Then specifically coming to the action of inferior rectus and left superior oblique. Look at the action of these two muscles. Now both the muscles in the right gaze are causing depression, okay? So the right inferior rectus, okay, and the left superior oblique, they cause depression of the eye in the right gaze. For example, right inferior rectus causes depression of the abducted eye, and left superior oblique causes depression of the adducted eye. Now let us look at the left gaze. These two muscles, the same muscles, okay, they cause the left superior oblique causes intorsion of the abducted eye, and the right inferior rectus causes extorsion of the adducted eye. So both muscles acting together cause the same action on right gaze, depression, and the torsion, they cause torsion on the left gaze. So just remember this. Why I discuss specifically these two muscles, I'll tell you. Now let us look at the pathophysiology of benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. I have chosen the example of posterior canal BPPV because that is the most common form. So in typical posterior canal BPPV, what happens is the canalith is located towards the ampullary side of the canal. Okay, so when we bring about the disc sulci position, okay, when the head low position in the disc sulci, what happens is the canalith drops down, okay, and it drops down and it causes ampullofugal movement of the endolymph, okay, and because of this ampullofugal movement of the endolymph, the kinocelium movement happens towards the excitatory side, towards the canal side, which is excitatory in case of posterior canal, and the excitation of posterior canal leads to upbeating torsional nystagmus. Let us discuss about the vestibulo-ocular reflex. In vestibulo-ocular reflex, I will specifically discuss about posterior canal excitatory pathways, because there are six different pathways for each of the canal. There are excitatory pathways and inhibitory pathways. So there are six different pathways. I will discuss specifically the posterior canal excitatory pathway. We are discussing only posterior canal. So the posterior canal projections go to the vestibular nucleus, specifically the lateral nucleus. From there, it goes to the third nerve nucleus and fourth nerve nucleus with the help of internuclear connection, that is medial longitudinal fasciculus. Right ocular motor nucleus supplies the right inferior rectus, and the right trochlear nucleus supplies the left superior oblique muscle. So we are discussing the left posterior canal excitatory pathway. So again, we are discussing about the same two muscles which we have discussed earlier, that is right inferior rectus and the left superior oblique. So the left posterior VORs or excitatory pathway specifically stimulates two muscles, that is right inferior rectus and left superior oblique. We have discussed the action of these two muscles. These two muscles are they cause depression in right gaze, okay, that is a slow phase of the nystagmus, and they cause on the right side it causes extorsion, and on the left side it causes intorsion. Both the muscles acting together, they move the upper pole of the eyeball towards the right side, okay. So that's why the fast component beats towards the left side. Okay, so this is the reason why in patients with vertical semicircular canal and its projection dysfunction, it causes vertical torsional nystagmus in the center gaze, and the nystagmus becomes predominantly vertical in one gaze and predominantly torsional in another gaze. This is the reason. And in case of posterior canal, it causes upbeating torsional nystagmus in the center gaze and predominantly upbeating on one side and predominantly torsional on the other side. In anterior canal, it can be downbeating torsional in the center gaze, predominantly downbeating in one gaze and predominantly torsional in another gaze. So these are my references. Thank you very much for watching this video. In my next video, I'm going to talk about why the infantile nystagmus, which was previously known as congenital nystagmus, retains its trajectory despite of changing the gaze. For example, if it is horizontal variety, then it remains horizontal in right gaze, it remains horizontal in left gaze, it remains horizontal in up gaze and down gaze. So I'm going to discuss that in my next video. Thank you very much.